Special event applications, there's none for this meeting.
Oh, wow.
Review of the agenda for the March 8, 2017 regular meeting.
Resolution 2017-96 appoints me as the temporary purchasing agent as per the guidelines of local finance notice 2012-09. These are consent agendas. Resolution 2017-97 releases a performance bond for 613 Bangs Avenue. Resolution 2017-98 is an authorization of an issuance of a duplicate tax sale certificate. 2799 is a resolution canceling a 100% disabled vet and providing a refund for taxes paid. 2017-100 and 101 is RCA projects. Is there any questions on the consent agenda?
You said RCA projects?
Yes.
What's going to be happening with that?
It's 198 DeWitt and 1025 Sewell. I don't have the full specs in front of me. Moving to individual resolutions. Resolution awarding contract for the affordable housing planner is 2017-102. There has been a change from the one that was posted online. As we discussed at the last meeting, and I sent this an email, we're changing the uses of the RCA fund to current fund, and the CDBG funds is still recommended as a planning purpose. Resolution 2017-103 is amending the temporary budget appropriations as we continue through the year, which, you know, this has become standard. 2017-104 is authorizing the payment of bills. Resolution 2017-105 is change order number one for the 2016 road program. You'll notice on this resolution, the cost is zero. The quantities that we took away and added had a net value of zero, but there were still changes to the contract amount, so it's a change order. Resolution 2017-106 is authorizing competitive contracting for emergency medical services. In going through records, the last time the city had this bid out was 1998 with a five-year contract sunsetting in the middle of 2003. Local public contracts law stipulates this must be out to bid every 5 years, so we're going to put this out to bid. Resolution 2017-107 is a point.
I apologize. Let's go back to the zero.
Yes.
Can we see in the future what was deducted and what was added?
Because yes, I have that information. I can pass it on.
Maybe it's something we don't want to deduct.
It was a catch basin repair, first replacement.
It's just,
yeah, it was, it
in
was
the future, let us just see.
Okay.
But there, thank you.
You're welcome. Resolution 2017-107 is the appointment to Sunset Lake Commission. And Resolution 2017-108 is appointment to the Zoning Board. That concludes the resolutions. For a second reading tonight on the public hearing for the capital ordinance, which is Ordinance 2017-2 is the bond ordinance for all our capital improvements this year, inclusive of the road program. Earlier today at the local finance board, the finance board signed off on the program and we can adopt this ordinance now. And then lastly is introduction of the 2017 municipal budget, which has to happen after the cap bank is done. There's a procedural issue there, which is introduction of Ordinance 27-10. The highlights of the draft budget. Now, please remember, this is just an introduced budget. We need to do this today for the transitional aid application. And as we move along in the transitional aid process, this budget will change as we receive our final state aid transitional aid awards. The tax rate has decreased. In 2017, we're estimating a municipal tax rate of 1.264. Last year, that was 1.292, which is a difference of 0.028 in the tax rate. That decrease is due to the increased valuation of the city properties. In 2017, the total valuation of all city properties is $1,372,672,200, which is an approximate increase of $77,000 from 2016, which was $1,295,329,500. That means the properties obviously are worth more today than they were last year. Further examples of that is the averaged home, average assessed value of a home in 2016 was $240,646, where in 2017 that value is $252,411, which is an increase of about $12,000 in value on the average house. What does this all mean? This means that we're, as we stand now, an increase in the average house on taxes of $90.95, which is down from last year of $150.72, which is further decreased by the 2015 average increase of $199.56. The transitional aid applications will be submitted to the state later this week or early next week. The budget proposes $850,000 in transitional aid, and this is 99% sure the last year we received transitional aid. With that, that's just the introduced budget. There'll be a further budget presentation when the actual budget is adopted. But at this point in time, we're requesting you adopt the budget by resolution so we can continue on with the financial process. That's it.
Okay. All right. Any matters from the city council?
I'd just like to thank our fire department for all that they did to help Ocean Grove and Neptune fight that fire in Ocean Grove, and also recognize some of the other folks in our community that helped out, the Asbury Hotel by providing space, and the Wonder Bar for assembling food and supplies for pets. So it was a really nice community effort from so many people here in Asbury Park. So I just want to acknowledge that.
First, I want to congratulate the Asbury Park High School, the big team. This is another year where they have gone to Harvard and competed with, I think, 276 schools, and five of them, they've won, I think, five of their debates. And so I want to congratulate them for taking part and being excellent in what they're doing. And second, last night I had the opportunity to attend a dinner in Atlantic City given by the New Jersey Recreation and Park Association. And at that time, Asbury Park received an Excellence in Design Award for the Springwood Avenue Park, and we received this plaque from the New Jersey Parks and Recreation Department. And it was a really nice event, and we had kudos from the city for what we've been able to do here.
Thank you. Jesse?
A lot of you know, might know that the last council meeting I was out, and I was out sick, and I tell you, the people in Asbury Park, I just can't thank them enough from calling and stopping by. But a strange thing happened with one of the people that stopped by was that I got the coffin, and I didn't mean the coffin in the face, but she was more concerned about her dog. So she asked me that if she had to take a dog to the vet, who to send the bill to. I said, Mike, send it to you. So,
so thank you.
I'd like to thank you all. Thank you.
So I'm not going to repeat what Eileen said, but I also wanted to thank the fire department and the community for coming out. In addition, I think Hot Mess, which is a salon on Cookman, offered free, I'm going to say, hair blow-ups and washing, and Lock and Shade, another salon, gathered materials as well for people who were put out from the families that were put out from the fire in Ocean Grove.
That's it? Question, excuse me, are they still receiving goods?
I believe so.
Okay, you know what it is, gentlemen?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll check with you after.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so Sunday we have two great events in Asbury Park, the St. Patrick's Day Parades, kicks off at 1 p.m., don't forget about that, and then you have the 25th, the Silver Anniversary Fishing Club Flea Market. If anybody would like to read an excellent article, it's in the March issue of the New Jersey / Delaware edition of the Fisherman Magazine, of the event history, how it started and how it's the biggest in the country and how it started other ones. It's also a great article about its president, Joe Pilato, and I know several meetings from tonight. I'll be, Joe won't come, but he'll be giving me like 5 checks to give to Asbury Park organizations because they donate so much back to the city. So I thank, and so does the St. Patrick's Day Parade. So again, and it's not gonna snow, so everybody's gonna be a little bit cold, but no big deal. Everybody show up, please. On a personal note, I would like to thank Pucci and Charlie Lomack, and I would like to thank the staff at DPW for what they did today. And that's all I have.
Matters by the city manager. We have a discussion item of new mobile payment application presented by transportation planner Mike Manzella.
There we go. Good evening, Council. So one of the things that the parking committee tasked me with was looking at other options for our mobile payment app for parking. So one of the first things I did was, you know, do an exhaustive research of what's out there, and I've spoken to Park Mobile, Pay by Phone, and Passport. I think, you know, after reviewing the terms and what each company offers, that Passport is probably the best solution for us right now to upgrade the app. The fee, the per transaction fee for users is lower. They're offering a lower fee, so 30 cents per transaction versus what we have now, which is 35 cents per transaction. So that alone is enough to consider it. But additionally, one of the things that Passport offers that the other providers don't offer or hadn't offered in the past was to go to a single zone implementation. So right now with our MPay to Park app, one of the struggles that people have is you have to select a zone and then put in a space number. And people are like, I don't know what zone I'm in. And every time they put in a space number, it says that their number's not in the zone. So Passport has developed in their programming a single zone implementation, so you can just put in the space number. Since our city has all unique parking space numbers for metered spaces, you can just punch in your number and park. There's no trying to find a zone. So that's a really a big benefit. Additionally, we've had some issues very recently with MPay to Park in terms of reliability. The past 2 Saturdays, the app actually crashed, and that may not be a big deal from people trying to pay, but our enforcement officers actually used the app to do enforcement, so they weren't unable to enforce while the app was down, which is a big problem. So Passport is definitely more reliable. They are a national firm all over the country. They have contracts in Chicago, Detroit, Boston, Toronto, Salt Lake City, Cincinnati, really big cities. So they're definitely reputable. They run on Amazon web service, Amazon hosted service. So it's a 99.99% uptime guarantee from Amazon. Additionally, they have options to pay, including call and text, not just the actual application itself. So on the signs that they would provide us, they will provide a call and text option on those signs. And the other big benefit is they offered, since we would be the first customer in New Jersey for Passport, but not the region, they offered to give us a branded app for free. So we would have a private label branded app. So people would not have to download the Passport app. It would be an Asbury Park app, Park Asbury Park, whatever we want to call it. And we can come up with some ideas, and I've already sketched some up. But that's another really big benefit that I think will help to kind of reintroduce the idea of parking in Asbury Park in a rebranded manner. So here's a new app. We're working on potentially installing new meters. So, you know, it's kind of the whole process of, you know, we're trying to rebrand it, essentially. Additionally, Passport offers the option of digital permits, which is something we might want to look into for 2018. It's not something that we would implement now, but it would give residents, employees, the option of buying their permits online, which I know has been a concern among some residents and employees that they can't necessarily make it to the Springwood Ave police substation between 9 and 4:30 to buy their permits. So this would provide an option for people to buy online, and then eventually, you know, kind of long-term where we're going is we may at some point transition away from a hang tag type permit and go to just a digital permit. So basically your license plate would be your permit. So you wouldn't have to come get a permit. So all of that can play into kind of our future plans for improvements to the parking program in general in the city. And it's an option they offer. The other big benefit is this is the only app company where you can add time without getting charged an additional transaction fee. So right now in MPay to Park, you pay the 35-cent transaction fee to pay to park. If you want to add time while your parking session is still active, you get hit with another 35-cent transaction fee. The way Passport works it is they don't actually close the transaction and charge you until the parking session is done. So that's a really big benefit. So if people add time, they're not getting hit with additional fees. Additionally, it's just a better design, honestly, from how it's used. We have someone on the park committee, Brett Morgan, who's he runs Co-Works and he's an app developer, and he said, you know, he just from using the different apps, he said this is definitely something that's easier to use. It's more user friendly, and Passport also offers a one-click sign-up. So if you want to sign up with Facebook, you can do that. It's just a one-click. So it's much easier for people to get on board, which will hopefully allow us to use the get better utilization out of our app. And if we use the app more, then that's less stress on the parking meters, and the overall system is better balanced as a whole and works better. So one other thing additionally, in the future, something we might want to consider, Chicago developed as part of their branded app. They have some data that shows on an aggregate level where parking might be available. And that's something we probably would have to pay extra for in the future, but it's something that is available within this app. So that's something that, you know, could be a benefit to users in the future that say, okay, during this time, historically, there's parking available on this block or whatever. So that's another benefit in the future potentially. So. I think that's all I have. Does anyone have any questions? Oh, the last thing is, if we decide to go with Passport and authorize them this month, they can have the app up and ready by Memorial Day. So it could be a quick transition before our peak season.
So could we generate any sorts of reports from this app? For instance, where our visitors are from? Any kind of analytics that we can create from this?
Yeah, I mean, we can do that now with our current app as well. I mean, I could pull data. I could ask them to pull data for zip codes.
Do we do that for marketing purposes at all?
No.
I don't know if we have in the past. But.
The business committee has asked for it. We've slowly been rolling out some information for them of where quote-unquote hot zones are, where there's been longer-term parking. But we're, quite honestly, nowhere near ready to start looking at where people are coming from to market to that area. We're not there yet.
Okay.
And again, I mean, with the MPay to Park, we only have about 3% utilization. So most of the people that come to the city and pay to park use the meters. So the data would be limited in terms of, you know, who was actually coming to the city if
and
you were to use
we
it.
And how would we promote this and the rollout of the new parking app?
So the Passport will provide a sign, one per meter, basically, that has the new branded app, has the instructions, has the call number, the text number. So one sign per every meter. And then they also will do the press release and social media and stuff like that. So we can, you know, we can work with groups within the city to promote it as well.
One of the things that had come up in the business committee was how to make sure that people stay where they are. And so we were talking about branding something like a coaster that here, you know, so
right.
If you're in a restaurant, you don't run out to go pay. This is just an easier way to do it. But again, we have to, you know, let the application work first before we start throwing out those things.
Something else I didn't mention, I'm sorry. Passport has a really deep merchant couponing program. So basically they have if we go with Passport, they would have a separate site for merchants to be able to log in, store owners, restaurants, whatever. They would have their own login and they can purchase as much parking or as little parking as they want. And then they would get a coupon code through the app to give to patrons to if they want to offer parking for them. So that's a really good benefit as well. And they have a pretty deep program and a deep track record with that, so.
I sent you a bunch of questions, and I was just going to bring up the coupon thing for business owners, because you didn't hit that one. And then the only other one that you didn't hit was, although you hit it in an email to me, was the complaint that we got that the MPAY required, I'm going to say $30 to stay in your account before, you always had to have a minimum balance?
Yeah, that's true. So that's the way it's set up now. MPAY does have the option to also offer the on-demand, as does Passport. It's just then the credit card transactions, the city would have to absorb some transactions for the on-demand payment, whereas right now there's almost no transaction fee for when you put a larger amount on. So what we can do a bunch of different things. I mean, we can offer the on-demand option, but really incentivize people to use the wallet through a number of ways, promote that more. You know, we could potentially look at some kind of discount or something for using the wallet. But I, you know, that's something we can talk about further. But either app does offer that option.
So people who now have money in MPAY, they've got $25 or $30 in there currently. Mm-hmm. If we now change this other app, what happens to that money that they've got invested?
So,
by Memorial Day.
No, but it's attached to a credit card, so it'll keep drawing.
So we can do a number of things. I think we would definitely tell people that we're transitioning to a new app, right? They could choose to leave the money in there because MPAY to Park is used in other cities in this area, Long Branch, Red Bank, Belmar. But they can also just email MPAY to Park and they will issue them a refund.
Okay. And the company offers I'm not saying that we would need this or not, but a stepped up marketing plan. So they like $1,000,
yeah.
$2,000, $3,000.
Right, if we want to.
Right. I'm not saying that we're going to get any of these marketing plans. I'm just saying that they are options in the spectrum of life.
Mm-hmm.
I think you got all of my I think you answered, at least for the public, all the questions I had. The merchant validating program basically is the coupon program that you already talked about. The app interfaces with the parking equipment.
Yeah.
No, you hit everything that I...
Okay.
So if we can get them up and running by Memorial Day, how quick can we get the MPAY to play out? Is there a secret contract we have with them that you don't know about?
No, they just require 30-day written notice. We actually, their
contract expired a few years ago.
Expired in 2013, technically.
So we're going month to month.
We go month to month.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And
so,
and this agreement
they need 30 days notice.
Right.
That Fred and I have already talked about it.
Okay, good. Well, sometimes there's secret contracts that we find at the last second.
And
so,
this
are
agreement
you looking for a decision tonight because
it's a resolution.
We need a resolution.
It's
okay.
A resolution because it's a national cooperative. It's a resolution anyway.
Okay.
So it's a national cooperative. So it would be for the next council meeting.
So I would just to Eileen's point about people, whether these people go to Red Bank or Belmar or not, or they're just coming to Asbury Park. I understand that we don't want to spend money on marketing, and I get it. It just puts it in the city to really do a good job about marketing.
Mm.
That's all I got.
I'm fine.
Is everybody good on this? So it's going to be on the next meeting. Is it going to pass? I mean, I'm going to vote yes. So, I mean, you can start the marketing tomorrow. Get your money out of the account. Let's wait till we pass the resolution.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Any other matters by the city manager?
Nope.
Matters by the city attorney?
Nothing at this time.
If not, we'll break until 7 for the regular meeting.
That's 3 minutes. So
that's
don't
3
anybody
minutes.
Go anywhere.
Far. Go potty. Councilmember Chapman?
Huh? Here.
Councilmember Clayton?
Here.
Councilmember Kendall?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
Please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection. Flag salute. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster, and the Star Ledger on January 3rd, 2017, and posted on the bulletin board the same date. All notices are on file with the city clerk. At this time, can I have a motion to open the meeting to the public, please?
Move it.
Second.
Each member of the public has 3 minutes to speak. When you come up to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
Looks like it's just me.
No.
Oh, I'm sorry, Rita. All right, Pat Fasano, Grand Avenue, Asbury Park. I just wanted to speak about the tax assessments in the waterfront. So Vince has done some research, and I'm starting to do some research to put together some information to provide to the mayor and the assistant mayor in the near future. But one thing that we discovered in meeting with Eric Aguilar is Asbury Partners, iStar Financial, are paying zero taxes on Bradley Cove. And they have never paid any taxes on Bradley Cove. So was the deed transferred? And if so, why are they not being assessed taxes on Bradley Cove? I mean, Brian Tripka made public statements saying that Bradley Cove was worth $20 million, and yet they pay no taxes on that property. Zero. So that's one question I'd like you to look into. The second thing that I would just like to put into perspective for the council members and the general audience. I heard the city manager say that the city of Asbury Park is assessed at $1 billion, $1 billion. Well, you know, the most valuable property in the entire city, in my opinion as a real estate professional, is the waterfront redevelopment area. I mean, that's the area that's zoned for over 3,000 units. And they pay only 7% of the taxes. Therefore, 93% is on us. So what I'm saying is Eric Aguilar's assessment of the 93 lots that they own is at $70 million. That includes the hotel, all the pavilions, everything. $70 million, and we're paying the rest. The 93% of the $1 billion we're paying. Okay, so I know that my property taxes in the CBD have gone up 300% since iStar has shown up, raising our property values through hype, but not creating any rateables at all to mention. I understand we did a hotel, but in doing that hotel, we lost 108 units on the block behind it. That's now a parking lot that was zoned for 108 units. That in alone would have been $50 million in assessments that we lost. And if you look at what they're paying for entire beachfront lots, it's less than I'm paying for one building on Cookman Avenue, just one building on Cookman Avenue. I'll be happy to trade Brian any building he wants on Cookman Avenue. Give me a full ocean block. Take your pick at my buildings on Cookman Avenue. But $70 million is the total assessment to iStar on the $1 billion we're being assessed. Thank you.
I didn't know you were running the meeting, Rita. Pat, and Michael, correct me if I could be wrong. I don't believe iStar owns the Bradley Cove because it's still the street. So I believe that's still owned by the city.
Correct. They own the redevelopment rights.
They don't own it.
No.
Well, they own the redevelopment rights for it.
That's a question down the road, but
so they say.
But
so they
to
say.
To answer your question, no, it's still owned by the city.
And everything else on the entire beachfront is only worth 7% of the city.
Well, that we'll look into, and I don't have the numbers in front of me, and we'll get back to you.
We'll provide you with the numbers later this week.
Okay.
Okay. I saw on the Rita Miranda, 8th Avenue. I saw on the Asbury Sun today that you're going to hire a consultant to check out the pilot programs, four of them. Wesley Grove, North Beach, the Griffin, and the Post. I don't know what that's about, but didn't we do this 2 years ago? And if you're going to check them out, you ought to check 550 Cookman, which is hardly paying anything,
and also the press building and the Steinbach's building. I don't know why they were excluded, why you just picked four. First of all, Wesley Grove and North Beach, they're the same one, so. The auditor did it the last time. Can't we have somebody from City Hall do it? We have a CFO, we have a treasurer, we have a tax collector, we have a tax assessor. Why do we have to hire somebody to do this? And the auditor, who got paid very well for doing it the last time. I'm not sure about the date, but I think it's about 2 years ago that he did do that. And I was just wondering why the city manager needs all these consultants to check everything out. I mean, like, I'd like to know what he's doing and what the CFO is doing. Shouldn't she be doing this, checking it out? And I wish you would check it out. And the other thing I'd like you to get is the report from the controller's office about the pilot programs. That's an eye-opener. I know you don't have it, but I do. And you should read it, because it's very informative, and I think you should be well-informed about the pilot programs. And I think that's what Pat's talking about. 550, I think they got 17 years. I mean, they have all these odd numbers. I don't know if Steinbach's building has 30 years. I know Asbury Towers has 40 years. I mean, like, I hate to say this, but none of us will be here then. And we're laying it on our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, which is not fair. So could you explain that, what was in the Asbury Sun today? Mr. City Manager?
When did you say you're done? Because
huh?
Once you say you're done, because...
Oh, okay. By the way, Cindy doesn't read that little script she has before the meeting starts. You didn't read it tonight.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act? Yes, I did.
When did you read it?
You were probably sleeping, but I did.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Okay.
You done?
I'm finished.
Okay. Michael, do you want to explain?
Oh, wait a minute. One more thing. The Affordable Act, weren't we supposed to get like $1,750 a unit affordable for the affordable, well, if they built the unit, then we were supposed to get $1,750 for each one. Where is that money? From North Beach and all the other buildings.
I don't know what she's talking about.
Yeah, we don't have a clue what you're talking about.
We were supposed to get money for each unit they put up at the beachfront. We were supposed to get money for the affordable units on the west side.
There was numbers set down, and I'm going to be wrong on the numbers. The first number was after 200 units were built, the city got $1 million. The next magic number, I know this, is 600. After 600 units are built, we get $1 million. Then the numbers keep on going. What it is after 600, I don't know. But it's not 1750 for each one built. There's a formula. It's in the plan. We'll get it to you.
Okay.
As far as Michael, you want to answer the other question? Let me just say before Michael answers the other question, I didn't read the Sun article, so. Inform me also, and although I was one of the people pushing to hire somebody with the pilots because they're so complicated, but you say you have something that we don't have. Do we have to Oprah it from you? Why don't you just give it to us?
Oh, it's about that thick. You have to get it from the controller's office.
Well, you give us ours and we'll make copies.
It's a controller report.
I'll give it to you.
No, maybe just as much as we give you stuff, you should give us stuff. Okay.
Okay. I'll get it to you. I'll bring it tomorrow.
Thank you, Reed.
Okay.
Okay, Michael, get it.
From my understanding, what you were talking about with the auditor reviewing the pilots was about 3-4 years ago?
2013-14.
Because there was some discrepancies in bills not going out. That was corrected, but as we've moved forward with it and have the new tax collector and a new CFO, we're finding some discrepancies from that math. We've had to refund a couple overpayments and bill some underpayments. Those four agreements were chosen because those are the more complex ones. Some, for example, will say your amount is $100, it goes up 2% every year. That's easy math. But some are based then upon a formula of first sale, versus assessment. It resets at certain points in time. So we want to have a second set of eyes review this, because I've reviewed some, done the math. CFO has done some, looked at the math. The collector has done some and looked at the math. If we want someone who's outside of us to review this and be able to make sure that what we've collected internally is correct, if we have to backbill people or give credits, because it goes both ways, because sometimes we've overcharged, to make sure that it's being done right. Those are the four more complicated agreements. Everything else that you mentioned is done internally. But we want to make sure that this has been done right since the last time it was looked at a couple of years ago.
That's it. So, the discrepancies that you're talking about, are they in favor of us or them?
Some have been in favor of us, some have been in favor of the residents. It goes both ways. So we want to make sure that this is being done correctly, because we want to make sure the billings are done right.
Do you know how many pilot programs we have?
I think the number's 12 off the top of my head. 12, yeah, 12 sounds about right.
Okay, Rita, your 3 minutes is up.
Okay.
Thank you.
Tracy Rogers, Springwood Avenue. I want to talk about 2017-102, the resolution awarding contract for affordable COLA. One, using CBG money outlined in the mission plan actually says using this money to affect low and moderate income people. Having this resolution that says we're looking to look for credits to take out any affordable housing that we may be listing doesn't, it conflicts with the interest of this money. So just as much as using RCA money, which was not our money, to affect issues of dealing with us, have the same mission with the CBG money. Right now, if we wanted to do that internally, and if we're honest enough to say we're looking at a full plan on what we need to do to go further, to go forward, I wouldn't mind a payment being made out of that, because it shows an interest in us actually doing what we look to do to come up with a solution. To go on to, if we want to internally look at past credits, or I can give you a plan for multiple cities that is easy to do, and I think we have the staff to do it. So I don't know why we're doing that. So basically, I would think you would table this to make sure we're looking at what we're focusing on inside this resolution, to look at it, and it does say to look for credits to take away from the obligation of affordable housing. So you using CBG money doesn't obligate that interest, because it's for low and moderate income people. Right now, listening to what Pat talked about, I would love to find out if the waterfront is only paying 7%, because if we're not focusing on an opportunity that we have to, one, get off, which we're slowly getting off transitional aid, but to make this a prosperous city. We have 93 lots up there. Right now, the plan was in 2000 was for the waterfront to make this city thriving. Well, the city has made itself thriving. The increase of people coming in, the diversity, we have to look at standing up for ourselves and making a suggestion to say, iStar, look, this is not a game anymore. We have to stabilize our city. We can work together, we can sit down, we can negotiate, but we gotta look at different options. This is ridiculous. We can continue to go over this and go over this. We need to solve the problem.
Michael, you wanna respond about the COA?
I don't know what to respond to. After Tracy spoke last meeting, how CDBG uses was eligible, I provided the documentation to you guys. It was a planning, under the planning auspices of it, for furthering affordable housing, which the spending plan and the subsequent plans that come out of this will help. So I don't know what else to comment on.
But once you had that comment to have credit to take out, goes against can't, I mean, you just, it's like saying, I'm gonna build a bank and rob it. You same thing. You can't, you, once you put that one comment in there, you've kind of taken out probability of using that money. Rewrite the RFP.
I don't agree with him.
Okay.
Louise Murray, Grand Avenue, Asbury Park. In response to Amy's remark about Bradley Cove possibly belonging to the city of Asbury Park, but it was in the contract, the redevelopment contract, that the developers obtained it. No reflection on you, any of you, but I am of the opinion that when you have contracts with the magnitude of that redevelopment agreement, I, for one, believe that none of you, don't take it personal, but whoever was involved, has the wherewithal or the intelligence to go up against redevelopers and their line of attorneys. And I really feel that these contracts should be looked over, even if the city has to pay for a professional to look them over, who has no skin in the game, who's going to look out for our interest. I agree, whether Rita does or not, with you fellas, you know, with you obtaining somebody to look over the pilot program. Because, you know, sometimes there's so much you have to do that you don't see the I's being dotted or the T's being crossed. But my opinion, because I've sat up there and I know what it could be like when you have to read a contract, I sat up one night and went word for word, figured it out, made an appointment with the attorney to make sure I knew what I was doing and what I obtained out of it. Frankly, that redevelopment agreement, whoever was involved with that, I think they missed something. Seriously missed something. So that's just an opinion, and you can either think about it or not.
Thank you.
But just, and Louise, you know, and even when you were on the council, you had special attorneys and everything. So when this deal was done in 2002, whoever the council people were, and nobody's taking it personally, I'm sure that council won't take it personally, they relied on their paid professionals. They did have paid professionals who made the recommendations before they voted on it, before they signed that contract. Now, was it good? Was it bad? You know, it's easy to say now, but in 2002, it was probably the best deal on the table. It was the only deal on the table. So it's a legal binding contract. We are going through the negotiations of trying to amend it. We're meeting weekly or biweekly, the latest, with iStar to try to renegotiate the contract. But they have a legal binding contract that was passed by a previous council on the advice of highly paid professionals.
The professionals that we had at the time are the attorneys that we used all the time, right? Or were they outside?
They were special attorneys. They were not like it wasn't like, say, Fred is the city attorney. It was a special redevelopment attorney.
And there are redevelopment attorneys involved in the process now.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Not for anything, John. I just see a revolving door. I keep seeing these names popping up from the time I was on council, and I go, oh, they're back again. I mean, it's like, I don't know. I haven't seen anybody, no more fresh faces, no new blood. So that's just my opinion. But like I said, it's my opinion.
Okay. Jerry?
Hello, Mayor and Council. Jerry Scrano, Long Branch. What I wanted to bring up was the building I had in mind was the Salvation Army building, but Main Street and Memorial Drive, we need to do something to make the stores look like the town's alive. I mean, it's kind of depressing when you go to other towns, they seem to have activity on Main Street, so we need to focus on that. The other thing is, I think we need more license plate readers for the city of Asbury Park, because with some of the things that are going on in the news, we need to do something to show that we're proactive for anti-terrorists or anything that could possibly happen on a crowded beach or when we have lots of events. where people come and go. I think license plate readers are a good part of the program. Of course, cameras, but we have to show that the city had the guard at the door instead of something could happen like over in Europe, like when the truck ran down the street or things like that. We need better safety plans here. I just wanted to put it out there. I don't know how you guys are going to do it. The less people that know about it, the better off we are. But, okay. The other thing, getting back to the city, is how are we doing with the department head monthly meeting? Is that posted online so we could see how we're saving money? Because if we're not going to have a tax increase, that'd be really good. I kind of like what Pat said. His story is pretty accurate. They have the best land and they pay the least tax. I think that's called serfdom in the old days. And then about the abandoned buildings, after that bad fire that happened in Ocean Grove, we're kind of lucky we don't have any big buildings like that abandoned. But all the abandoned buildings should come under scrutiny as soon as possible to make sure that they're sealed. Because you know what happened probably in Ocean Grove? Nobody cared that homeless were going in and out of that hotel, did nothing about it. But a lot of people are suffering because someone saw what was going on and did nothing about it. And we have to be proactive. Thank you very much. How are we doing with those monthly meetings? Are they posted online yet?
That one to you.
Are you talking about the monthly? I'm not sure what you mean with monthly meetings, or are you talking about what we've talked about before with the performance stuff?
Well, a little of this, a little of that. I mean, you're the business manager. I'm not. I just think the public needs to know how we're cutting back. And I'm sorry I don't speak plain English. That's why I was taught in college.
The performance measurement system we're updating into the beta testing on Friday. I talked with our consultant this morning driving down to Trenton. But I don't know what you want to know when I meet with staff what goes on there?
Well, don't they give you a report and there's something in writing and then we see how we're not, instead of going like this, we're only going like this?
Well, the goal is to go like this.
Wow.
Not to go
that I'm not asking for miracles.
Thank you. But that's the performance measurement aspect of it. And we've been beta testing it. We've been looking, Anna is here. We met with the consultant on where to put it on the website, what's the best way to put it on the website. We've been testing it to make sure all the links work. It's complex, but we should be able to roll that out. We're slower than we want it to be, but yes, it's coming. So you'll see those items. Hopefully, we'll go live in April. We're testing it. It's there. We're just
listen. You're bound to make mistakes, but at least you can always tweak the mistakes.
We want to minimize them.
Okay. Thank you very much, Council.
And then, as far as the abandoned buildings or abandoned properties, Rob McEwen, I think, has been doing an excellent job with that with abandoned properties. I'm not going to tell you which one, but one that's been a pain in the neck for years. Just because they were forced into the abandoned properties, they had to pay the fees and everything, it's under sale. So that's like the third one that's being sold, fourth one that I know of that's been sold because we started, Mr. McEwen has started the abandoned properties through the council's consent and advice.
We're gonna have another list, hopefully within the next 2 or 3 months. And on the boarding upside, we've actually changed from requesting wood to a fireproof material that makes it look more like a window than a board. Rob's been testing it out. We've talked about it in a couple of properties, and both the property owner and the banks, if they put it up, it's a little bit more cost, but it's a little bit better surface, and there's been no complaints about it.
And that, as far as license plate readers, I couldn't tell you how many we have, but if we're lacking them, and we just did a $3 million capital plan, and we need to buy more license plate readers for the police department, you got my vote in a heartbeat. I mean, so that's something between the police department and the city manager to figure out. And, you know, obviously, like you said, we're not going to tell you where they're at or what cars where and everything. But if we don't have enough, I agree with you, they're the best things in the world. I mean, they tell you everything in a split second. So.
And then, yeah, I knew that one was about Salvation Army. I'm also thinking about the Board of Education building. You have people investing money on fixing up Memorial Drive and Main Street. Then you have two big buildings that are eyesore. At least
the old YMCA with the thing going, I mean, the scaffold around it, it looks like they're fixing it up.
Or they're,
better than nothing.
I don't know if they're fixing it up or they're protecting themselves from lawsuits. That's a good question. Michael, can you look into that?
Mm-hmm.
Because
that's why I brought it up.
Well, no, I appreciate that. I saw the scaffold and I forgot to ask, like, are they just protecting themselves from lawsuits because of the fallen debris? Or submit plans to building to fix the building, so to construction. So we'll get you the information on that. Thank you, Jerry.
Motion to close public?
Move it.
Because there was a...
Next on the agenda is minutes. We have three sets of minutes tonight. Executive session minutes of February 22nd, 2017. Workshop minutes of February 22nd, 2017. And regular minutes of February 22nd, 2017. Have a motion to adopt the minutes, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Consent agenda, 2017-96, appointing Michael Capobianco as temporary purchasing agent as per the guidelines of FLN 2012-09. 2017-97, a resolution of the City of Asbury Park releasing the performance bonds at 613 Bangs Avenue, Block 2505, Lot 2.01, and accepting maintenance guarantee. Resolution 2017-98, resolution authorizing issuance of duplicate tax sale certificates 402-7. 2017-99, resolution canceling and refund of 2015 through 2017 pilot charges due to 100% disabled veteran exemption. 2017-100, award a contract for regional contribution agreement project. This is for 198 DeWitt Avenue. And in 2017-101, again, it's award a contract for regional contribution agreement for 1025 Sewell Avenue. Does anybody wish any of the consent resolutions be pulled from the consent agenda? Hearing none, can I have a motion?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
For individual resolutions, Resolution 2017-102, resolution awarding contract for affordable housing planner. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Have a second?
I'll second it.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
I have a question.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm sorry. If anybody's still confused on this, I'd rather make a motion to table than to defeat it, so.
I agree.
Well, this is our second table, so then I would just say meet with Michael this week, so we vote on this one way or the other. Well, you weren't here for the last table, Jesse,
yes.
So I get that. No problem there. I'm just saying move it at the next meeting latest, one way or the other. I'm not advocating a way.
Will they waive the 21-day time frame?
The what?
Wasn't there in the contract a 21-day time frame to award it in the RFP? No?
No, you have to sign a contract.
No, sign the contract.
Well, yeah, but you haven't awarded anything to sign a contract.
Okay. Again, just because I didn't hear a second, so something tells me it's either going to fail or I don't know what's going to happen. So if other people have more questions and you'd rather wait another 2 weeks and ask the questions and know what you're voting on, I'd rather table it than have somebody up to you guys. What do you want to
do? Well, there's a motion to table. It's on the table, so.
Well, the motion was to approve.
Oh,
right.
So someone would need to make a motion to table. If that's
I'll make a motion to table it.
Second.
Okay. Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
No.
Mayor Moore?
No.
Okay, this will be tabled until the next meeting of March 22nd. Next is Resolution 2017-103, Resolution Amending Temporary Budget Appropriations for 2017 Budget. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-104, Resolution Authorizing the Payment of Bills in the Amount of $1,664,972.58. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-105, Resolution Authorizing Change Order Number 1 for the 2016 Road Program. Have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-106, Resolution Authorizing Competitive Contracting for Emergency Medical Services. Can I have a motion to approve, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-107, Resolution Authorizing Appointments to the Sunset Lake Commission. The council wishes to appoint Chester Bowles, alternate 2, with a term expiring June 30th, 2018. Can I have a motion to approve this resolution?
Move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2017-108, appointment of members to the Zoning Board of Adjustment. The council wishes to appoint Jennifer Satter as alternate number 2 with a term expiring 12/31/17. Can I have a motion to adopt this resolution?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinances, introduction. Ordinance 2017-10. Ordinance
was to... Was there 109 or no?
No.
No?
109 is...
109, we have to do the ordinances first.
Okay.
Ordinance 2017-10, ordinance to exceed the municipal budget appropriation limits and to establish a cap bank per NJSA 48:4-45.14. Can I have a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
This ordinance would be carried for a public hearing to April 12, 2017. Ordinance 2017-11, an ordinance establishing salaries of certain employees within the city of Asbury Park, County of Monmouth, New Jersey.
Could that be explained?
Michael.
This creates the position of media technician to work with APTV. There's been some problems maintaining volunteers due to them being volunteers. So if need be, we might have to start paying people. This is creates the ordinance of the minimum and maximum for hourly and an annual rate for a part-time position. There's no budget cost to this. This would simply move internally, actually on the budget document, the money that is allocated for APTV in their operating expenses, the O&E, to salary and wages, the S&W. There's no change in cost to the city.
Thank you.
Can I have a motion to introduce ordinance 2017-11?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing for this ordinance will be scheduled for March 22nd, 2017. Second reading, ordinance 2017-2. Bond ordinance providing for various 2017 capital improvements by and in the city of Asbury Park and the county of Monmouth, state of New Jersey, appropriating $3 million, therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $2,875,172 bonds or notes of the city to finance the part of cost thereof. Have a motion to open this ordinance to the public?
Move it.
Second. Is some of this bond money going to be paid by somebody else, or are we paying the whole thing? Not a grant, or I remember hearing something about that. No?
There's
how much?
If we receive a grant as part of the Main Street Streetscape application for, I don't remember what the grant was called. We needed to have matching funds, so this allows for the possibility of the matching funds for the grant the city applied for about 2 months ago. It was the one for, was I can't remember the good name of the grant now. It was the lake one that the was Lake Commission wanted to do.
Yeah.
Right.
The TAP funds.
The TAP grant.
So this would authorize us to spend the local matching funds that would need it as part of the TAP program. That's all. Otherwise, it's all city funds.
What are the matching funds?
50-50? No, it was less than that. It was 25%. 25%, I believe.
25% of this bond?
No, of that aspect of it, which we, in the bond, there's $150,000 for Main Street streetscape improvements as part of the TAP, and if DOT ever paves Main Street, we have to also do the streetscape improvements.
And is this what you went to Trenton for today?
Yes, for approval of this ordinance.
How many people approved this today on that board?
1, 2, 3, 4, 7. 7 members of the board were there.
They were all there?
I believe there's 7, yes.
It seems like an awful lot of money to be borrowing.
The Director of Local Government Services, who was also chair of the board, actually commended the city for acting like a normal municipality and doing these things.
Mm-hmm. Are you going to read this whole thing tonight? The bond issue?
Mm-mm. It was available to the public.
Huh?
It was available to the public.
Oh, but you don't have to read it.
I don't have to read it, no.
Okay, because it's a lot of reading.
Motion to close.
Move it.
Second.
All right, I have a motion to adopt ordinance 2017-02.
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
And last but not least is the introduction of 2017 municipal budget. We have resolution introducing the 2017 municipal budget. Have a motion to introduce the budget, please.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing for the 2017 municipal budget at this time is scheduled for April 12th. Motion to adjourn.
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Okay.
Tim said.